morning and welcome to Morning Matters. This morning we have a treat for you. We are going to be interviewing the number one selling artist in the history of Belize. If you are Belizean and you're living in Belize, chances are you know who it is. But if you're not, chances are you don't know who it is. We have with us this morning, we have Bern Velasquez. Bern, good morning. How are you?
Hey, good morning. It is a pleasure to be here.
It's a pleasure to have you.
Actually, it's an excitement and a pleasure to be here.
It's very, very wonderful to have you on our set this morning because, I mean, when people look at you, they say, man, this sounds sexy boy, but behind this sexy boy, there's a good story. And I would, I'm glad that you decided to come and sit in with us this morning to help to share your story. I feel that your story can impact a lot of other people in a positive way.
Thanks.
I think that more than you know, you represent hope for many when they hear your story. So for the Belizeans that know him as a guy selling CD, he's more than just a guy selling CD. He has a story that I'm sure will not only touch you today, but it would probably impact you for a very long time. So I encourage you to sit back, grab something to drink, whatever it is that will make you comfortable, because this will be one of the most entertaining and interesting hours of your life. We'll be back.
Looking for quick and easy baking? Try Grace Baking Powder. It comes in a convenient 10-gram packet. Grace Baking Powder. Great for my pancakes, waffles, fry jack, flour tortillas, muffins, waffles. Wow! How quick and easy! Grace Baking Powder. So convenient, easy to store, you love it! It's good enough and fresh whenever you need it. Another fine product brought to you by Grace. For recipes, go to gracerecipes.com. It's time for Grace. Grace, bringing good taste to life.
Welcome back to Morning Matters right here from Belize City. Bern Velasquez in with us this morning. Bern,
yes.
How are you feeling?
I feel good.
You look good.
Thank you.
Before we get into the deep story.
Mucho gracias.
De nada, de nada. How do you keep your body looking this good? This is just before we get into the real story. Let's jump to the chase. That's a question that people would be wanting to know.
Proper food intake, cardiorespiratory, resistance training, supplementations, and accountability.
Wow. Can you give me that in English?
It's not easy.
Oh, wow. Have you always been into fitness and working out and...
No, I haven't. I used to be Bernie Macaroni. That means Bernie who is skinny like macaroni, and we call him Bernie Macaroni.
And then what happened?
I got tired of being that kid that was picked on, the skinny little one in high school where everybody wanted to measure my muscle. Can you make a muscle? And I make a muscle, and they come measure it to see if they could palm it, and they could palm it. And they laugh, and I'm just like, you know, oh, yeah, man, it's cool. This is how I like it. And deep inside, I was like, I got to do something about this. So, you know, when you're in high school, you start, got all these girls around and boys start showing off to impress girls. And I'm the little Bernie Macaroni. I didn't want to be that.
There you go. Well, so, I wonder where their muscle is now.
Ooh, don't throw such a hard stone at them.
I'm just kidding.
They might be watching this show.
That's good. I'm sure that they're
happy.
Your
show is watched around the world. I was watching it once when I was in El Salvador. I watched it when I was in Brazil, and I watched it when I was in Mexico City.
Well, thank you, sir.
As soon as I came to Belize, it was a must that I got on this show.
I am glad that you chose to come here. Bern, tell me a little bit about your upbringing.
A little bit about my upbringing.
Where were you born? Where did you grow up?
I was born in Belize, and at a young age, actually 3 years old, my mom went to the States trying to make it better for her 10 kids. It was 10 of us, 5 boys, 5 girls, fighting amongst each other. Life hard, things the right, pops out in the key fishing, come back with a nice little amount of fisherman money. That money you would think would be spent in the home. You know, my father being the father he was, a lot of time he made some mistakes like allocating the funds with other women, not taking care of home. My mom getting fed up like, you know what? I go in a states, I'll make it better for my big name. She got a states illegally, did the best she could, while Bern to give problems, trouble, the fight with the next siblings, the oldest one, about 15, 16, can't handle the situation. But we all, in the end, got along, got all right. By the time I was 12, 13, I was in the States with everybody else. Where my mom did was like, work hard, send for the oldest one first. The oldest one would come, start working, and help send for the next one and so forth.
Nice.
So I was the youngest boy. I had a younger sister. And by the time they got to me, it was like I had all this mad chip on my shoulder, like, y'all don't left me to rot in Belize. I don't get beat a chance and everything else that comes with growing up without your mom and pops around. And I had a real chip on my shoulder, you know what I'm saying? So I didn't take it very well. Now, like I said, the struggles was hard for my moms and my brother and sisters trying to help to you know, just raise this family and keep this family together. But I didn't really see that as a kid. So I was just like all about me, selfish, and arrogant with an inferiority complex. And I wasn't gonna take orders very well.
So when you went to the States, you were on fire? Would you say
I was on fire.
You were on fire. You came, you went there and you started to give trouble? Is that what you're saying? Like, what kind of trouble did you give?
Like, I would eat, not want to wash my plate. You know, my brother would come home from, my brother would have to leave the house like 5 o'clock to go to work in the morning. After work, he got to go to school. He'd get out of school like around 9 o'clock. Then by the time he get home around 10:30, 11 o'clock, you know, we're sleeping, but all our dirty dishes is there because nobody want to wash their plate, and especially me. So it'd be like, you know, Bern, you know, I don't want to go to work, and after I get off work and school, come home and wash your dishes after you eat. Can you please wash your plate? And I'm like, you know what, if y'all gonna try to talk this crap to me, I might as well get out of your house, because you know, I'm not having this.
Where did you go?
Well, I left. I was staying in the streets, you know, Venice Beach, Venice, California, staying in the park benches.
Seriously?
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Because you were a bigger man than them.
Yeah, I felt like, you know, nobody gonna push me around and have me washing
no dirty
dishes.
So how did you make a living? How did you eat? How did you put bread on your table?
My table? I didn't have a table. I have a...
How did you put bread in your belly?
It seems to me it's easier to wash the dishes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But me being stubborn and all of that, I left. I started hanging out with the wrong crowd. I knew some guys who were basically selling drugs from my house. They were selling drugs, and I always had a lot of women and gambling and doing that type of activity. So it was a place where anybody could kind of like hang around, and I hung around, and before you know it, I could sleep on the floor in the corner right
there.
No
chores.
You know what I'm saying? No chores. Nobody gonna have me wash dishes. But it was very difficult, and I regret doing it. As a matter of fact, I could think about what it was like when I left, you know, when my brother was like asking me to wash my dishes, and just to see that look in his face, to see how sad and how hurt it made him feel to know that I was actually leaving instead of washing my dishes. It's like he loved me, but he's not gonna beg me to stay.
No.
But at the same time, it's hurting him to see me leave. And I knew that it hurt him more than it hurted me. So that made me okay with leaving. Feeling like I'm winning because it's hurting him. I know it's hurting him. I know he's scared that I'm leaving.
How long did you live that life?
I lived that life for about a year. I say it took me about a year, because when I left, I actually started going to another school in LA. I wanted to be in LA area. I was in Valinda. My brother was living in Valinda, which is an outskirts, nice neighborhood. Mm-hmm. I was going to a nice school, William Workman High School in the city of Industry. You know what I mean? Real nice environment. But now I'm back in LA around knuckleheads like myself. I'm in that environment.
Well, at least you didn't stop going to school.
No,
at least
I
you
didn't
kept
stop.
Always, in school.
Right. I always felt like it was very important. I always knew that school was very important, so I never stopped going to school. And as a matter of fact, while I was hanging out with the thugs and the hoodlums, they really actually encouraged me to go to school and was even giving me money, like lunch money and stuff like
nice.
That. So that was cool. You know, they were like, yeah, little homie right here, this gonna be the genius in the family. Little homie going to school, and you know what I mean? So
I found purpose there. I would imagine in some crazy way you found purpose amongst those guys. I mean, because then not only were they, you had the freedom to do crazy stuff, but you were also going to school. So there was something good that was coming out of that. God was still shining on you.
God was still protecting me and keeping me safe. But it was not an environment that I wanted to be in at all.
For sure.
I mean, the lifestyle that these guys was living and the things they were carrying out in society doing, they would come back at end of the day talking about these things. And all I would say to myself is like, oh my God, I just got to get out of here. And I will never live a life like that. You know what I mean? I didn't want that life for myself. Actually, I felt like I was scared to be around that.
How did you escape that lifestyle? Well, or did you?
I did escape because I was doing good in school at Manual Arts, and my brother offered me an opportunity to come back home. He was like, look, you know, you could come back home if you want. And I came back home, of course, and went back to William Workman High School. So I was back in a good environment again.
What was your adult life like in California?
My adult life was like, to me, it was a very fake life. You know, I always been into acting and modeling, and I used to use the music just to get girls and popularity and stuff like that because people like my style and all of that. But it was a very phony lifestyle. You know, had the Escalade with the Lamborghini doors and the booming sound system. And
what was your dream like then? What was your dream when you were in the States? What was your dream?
So my dream, I didn't really have any real dreams, you know what I mean? I was just going to school, basically staying afloat, and at the same time doing modeling and acting, and I was believing that I could make it as an actor or as a musician. So I don't really have to do too well in school anyway if I don't want to.
When did you come back to Belize?
Well, I got deported. I didn't come back to Belize. I got deported back to Belize. Why are you laughing? What's so funny?
I'm not laughing.
Okay. Well, I got deported back to Belize October 23rd, 2007.
Okay. What was that like? What was that transition like for you?
The transition of being deported was crazy. You know, but I embraced it well. I was already planning on actually moving back to Belize anyway, because I had released an album called Life After Deportation before getting deported, before knowing I could be deported and all of that. And the album was doing very well. So I was using the money to invest in a biodiesel company, manufacturing and distributing biodiesel gasoline. And in the process of doing that, and traveling from Belize to the States, is when I got held in Miami International by Homeland Security. So that's when I got held and was detained to be deported for 10 months. So the 10 months, even though it was a travesty being in Chrome Detention Facility, it gave me time to think about what I'm gonna do when I get back. And it gave me time to try to organize myself. I used that time to organize and strategize. It wasn't to sit there and be depressed or beat up on the world or to fight against anybody. The fight would now be between me and the universe.
What was life like when you came home?
When I came home, life was different. You know, I left Belize as a kid. I came back, I'm a grown man now, and I'm gonna have to make this my home. And even though it was my home country, there's a much more that comes with a home than just being born in a country.
You know, Bern, earlier when we were talking, you made some very valuable points that I don't think a lot of people pay attention to. When somebody gets sent home, especially if it's a place that they didn't grow as a man, like you didn't develop, you didn't get a home, you didn't get a job, you were just born here and then you were sent back here, you don't know anybody, you have very little family, because even though they might be related to you by blood, you've never had any real experience with them.
Exactly.
How then do you decide or you figure out where you're going to sleep? Because now you're pretty much homeless.
Right.
You're homeless in a country that you were born, but you're homeless because you haven't planted any seeds here, because you're busy planting your seeds where you live.
Exactly.
How did you overcome that that challenge to be where you are today?
Okay. Well, right off the bat, while I was in Homeland Security custody, I decided that, you know what? At first I was fighting them to not get deported, because I'm like, everything I own is in the States. I have a green card. I knew the struggles that it took for my family to obtain a green card for me. And I didn't want to just say, take your green card back and send me back home. So I was fighting and doing everything I could to maintain that. But when I realized I was fighting against a government that I would not be able to defeat, and I was spending thousands and thousands and thousands upon thousands of dollars that was going right down the drain between lawyers and America, I was like, you know what? The best thing for me gonna do is hold on to the little bit that I have and go back to Belize. So I was like, time to go back to Belize. Started making plans and arrangements to situate myself as far as obtaining somewhere to stay, a home, and then asking them to please send me back. You know what? You said you're holding me to, you're detaining me to deport me. Please go ahead and deport me. Let me make it easy for you. If you're holding me because I have no crime and I'm in a hostile environment for 10 months, I felt kidnapped. I felt trapped. You're in an environment where there are riots. People are fighting. People are getting stabbed. People are defending themselves. And if someone attacks you and you don't do nothing about it, you're looked at as a punk. And that is the worst thing to be looked at there when you're in that type of environment.
So when you came to Belize, what was the first thing you did?
Dust off the old dust from America. Accepted that I was in Belize. Thank God. I gave thanks to God for getting me back here safely. I prayed for guidance, discipline, and then I hit the streets running because I knew that I would be able to defeat whatever the challenges that would come. I don't care what the challenges were.
For the people that don't know, what do you mean when you said you hit the streets running?
Hit the streets running meaning, okay, I'm here in Belize. I have nothing, but I'm going to create everything that I want. I'm going to create an opportunity to get whatever it is that I need and whatever I want.
How did you go about that? And the reason I'm asking you this is because I think a lot of times when people get disappointments, whatever they are, it might be a huge disappointment for them when somebody else looking from the outside might say, well, that's not a big thing. But for them, it's a huge disappointment. We see people get sent home all the time and now they're still living on the streets or they're on drugs or, you know, or they're trying to make it back into the States. None of those things you didn't waste your time with.
No.
You know, so how did you manage to make your opportunities?
Okay, well, I feel like everybody have a talent. My talent being music. I feel like I'm a good artist, you know what I mean? And I feel like I could create scripts and write songs and I can record them. And I already had some recordings, so I just used the recordings and started selling my music in the streets, door to door. I figured, you know what? I'm gonna go to every house in this country if I have to and go with my CD, knock on the door. I would knock on the door. Hello, good morning, miss. Yes, I'm here to deliver your CD. And you know, this is, she's like, well, I ain't never had no CD. Well, then you're just lucky because I'm here to deliver a CD and you didn't even order one. See how lucky you are. You know what I mean?
I love it. I absolutely love it.
Where do I sign on this? I open the CD right away. We had to pay too much for that thing. You know what I mean? No, man, this thing have $20. But if you have less, don't worry about that because we're important that you have this, you know? That I know you got a thing for play that, man. Just put it on the wall. Yeah, look good on the wall. And when you got visitors, then I see you support Bern. And you got a copy of Bern CD on your wall. Even though you know might got a DVD or a CD player. You know, that's how I approached it.
How many did you eventually sell?
Over 215,000. The first project I did, I pressed up 10,000. And before pressing up the 10,000, I spoke to many people. Because I had like a little bit over like $8,000. And to do the CDs would cost me $7,000. It would cost almost the $8,000. It was like $7,500.
You'd be broke by then.
It was like $7,500. You know what I mean? So I would have like $500 left to eat and maintain myself while this project is being shipped to me.
Yes.
And when it comes, it was budgeted for me to be just about broke just on that day. You know what I mean? Real talk. So I spoke to Andy Palacio. I spoke to Mr. Peters. I spoke to Papa Curly. I spoke to Stone Jam. I spoke to a lot of people who are instrumental in the business and who've been coming back and forth to Belize doing business and doing music in Belize. And most of the people I spoke to told me straight up, they say, look, if I were you, I wouldn't take all of my money go invest in nothing. Because if you put all your egg in 1 minute basket, and in a workout, you are stuck. people told me, look, Belizeans don't really support Belizean artists. Uh-huh. So if either you had just done me about 1,000 or 500, and if that work out, then I would have done more. But the cost that it would have cost me, that I was paying for 10,000, was like a couple hundred more than if I did 1,000. It was like real cheap to do the 10,000. So I did 10,000. And now basically all my money is gone. And I'm just waiting for my project. When my project got, I got my first load of the project at the Ladyville post office, before I walked out, I already sold 5 CDs. Before I walked out of the post office. And it was only 2 people in there when I went to go pick it up. But I sold 5 already. You understand? And when I saw how much CDs I was selling, it was like interesting to me, because and it gave me the encouragement right off the bat. So I say it's very important to support these artists when you see them trying, because just I remember that lady that looked at me and she was like, yes, I want one, you know what I mean? And she bought the first one. I wish I could have asked her name to just say thank you to her right now, because that was encouraging. Mm-hmm. It was very encouraging. And so when I left out of that post office, I felt confident. I felt secure. And I felt like, even though I was already planning to do this, I felt good doing it.
You had affirmation. When we come back, we'll be talking a little bit more with Bern, where he is now, where he intends to go. And in the meantime, we're also going to ask him to help us answer some matters. We'll be back.
Company who brought you Buendia freeze-dried coffee, Grace 100% pure Colombian coffee is made in Colombia, considered among the finest coffee regions around the world. Naturally freeze-dried, Grace 100% pure Colombian coffee is exposed to less heat than other coffee brands to preserve the flavor and aroma to make the perfectly convenient cup of coffee you deserve. Have a buenos dias with Grace.
Recipes, go to gracerecipes.com. It's time for Grace. Grace, bringing good taste to life.
With the high cost of fuel these days, every fill-up can be a curiously scary experience. Rising gas prices have transformed to the point where it feels like it can cost you the shirt off your back. That's why we created Lucas Fuel Saving Motor Oils. Their special additives increase compression and minimize friction, improving fuel mileage. With Lucas, you'll keep from losing your shirt, or even worse.
Welcome back to Morning Matters. Bern Velasquez in with us this morning. Quite an interesting story. I think it helps to make one realize that not many things come easy and nothing comes knocking on your door. And I think you get great appreciation for the things that you attain when you stick to it. Stick to the plan. Don't get beaten down. Like he said, he just dusted himself off. You know, and being able to dust yourself off is a gift by itself. It sounds easy, but it's not that easy. You have to have a special mind to be able to dust yourself off.
Yeah.
You certainly do. All right, we're going to ask Bern where he is, where he intends to go, but this is Morning Matters, so we have to answer some matters, and I'm sure that Bern is more than equipped to help us with these matters. He came from a family of 10, Belizean parentage. He's migrated. He's traveled all over the world since. He's seen a lot. I'm sure he's had a lot of girls come bounce up on him. So, this should be an interesting one. Are you in a relationship, Bern?
At this moment, I'm not.
How difficult is it for a man like yourself to stay in a relationship?
It is not difficult for me. You know what I mean? I feel that I know what I want. You know, I'm not no little boy. I know what I want in a relationship. So when I have what I want, I maintain it.
And I ask that because you're not stationary. 1 minute Bern is here, the next minute he's in Argentina, the next minute he's in Mexico, the next minute he could be anywhere, because that is how you're chasing your dream. That is the life that, and
right.
And I would imagine it's not easy to find somebody that is that flexible.
Right.
Right. So it might be a little bit difficult for you to find a serious relationship.
Exactly.
And by extension then to maintain it, because.
Right. As a matter of fact, I believe as an artist, while chasing your dream, you cannot have a relationship. I always felt like you can't. Well, I got convinced by one very good person that, hey, you know, I can. And so I had a relationship with her, and our relationship today is no more. But she's still a wonderful person in my eyes, you know.
That's how it happens.
And the relationship just is not what it is. And that's because of her doing, not my doing. You know what I mean? So that's why I don't have a relationship.
Are you clear when you know, you're a good looking man, you go to Mexico, you go wherever, all these girls bouncing up on you, like I would say. Are you clear with them? Because everybody, I'm sure, would want to have a relationship with you. Because
I have a wide variety to choose from if I should choose to have a relationship. I have a woman who's 40 years old who's a virgin. And
she wants to give her her whole being to you?
She wants to give her whole being to me. You know what I mean? So she sends me all these messages about why we should not have sex until after we married. And she feels like I'm the man she wants to marry. She feels like I'm the greatest blessing that ever came into her life. And she's in love with me.
How do you feel?
How do I feel? I feel very privileged and honored and highly favored. You know what I mean? Because she's actually a very attractive, very good woman. As a matter of fact, when we're done with the show, I'll show you the messages and let you see this woman. You know what I'm saying? I'll even let you speak to her if you want.
I believe so. What's your hold up?
No. The thing is this, I don't think that this is something that comes easily.
No, that's a gift.
And another thing, I have a 44-year-old woman who is a prostitute. Now, this woman right here is amazing to me. And I have to choose between a prostitute and a virgin. If I should choose, and those would be the two. Though you notice those are the first two I mentioned.
And there's everything in between. You can't get to any more extent than that.
Exactly.
At 40, a virgin and a prostitute.
No, at 40, a virgin.
At 44, a prostitute.
At 44, a prostitute. And this 44-year-old woman who is a prostitute, she could watch a show and she would be like, my baby is just so cute. You know what I mean? Why would she be this way? Because I met this very classy, beautiful, young looking woman in an environment where I would have never thought that of her in any way, shape, or form. And as a matter of fact, I was doing an interview actually in Playa del Carmen while she was waiting for me, and I'm looking at her on the beach while she's waiting, and I'm like, man, she's so beautiful and so classy. And you know, and I was like, so as you can see, I'm an artist, and that's why I was doing that interview. Sorry for have you waiting. So what do you do? Oh, I'm a prostitute. You know, I mean, she said it just
like. Did you think that she was joking when she first said it, or did you realize that she was serious?
I thought she was probably joking, but she's probably serious, because I don't really take anything too lightly. Like, anybody could be anything. And she seemed like she was being genuine. And I was like, she said, I hustle after that. So I was like, she's probably serious, you know?
Yeah, you don't say those two words in the same sentence and not be serious.
Right. So I was like, really? Like, what do you really do? Come on. She's like, I already told you. And I'm like, okay, so
how do you choose?
How do I choose? Right now, I don't have to choose. You know what I mean?
You can still be friends with both of them.
I'm friends with both of them.
I love it. Let's jump into somebody else's matter. You are quite an interesting guy, I swear. Good morning, Rhonda. The man that I live with went on to work for 3 days. When he comes back, I found a male sex enhancement drug in his bag. I tried to speak to him to get an understanding as to why he has this. His response is that I need not to worry about him because he's not doing anything. This really hurt my feelings, and he's changing the way I feel towards him. I am finding that I am becoming miserable. My solution is for us to have protected sex. Tell me, what do you think?
She's feeling that way because you have a sex enhancement drug?
Yes.
Well, I don't see why she should. But, I mean, you should be having protected sex anyway for many reasons, more than just if a man is sleeping around. But, I feel that the enhancement could have been for anything. Maybe he's not getting sexually aroused and he needs this drug to help him. Or maybe he feels like it helps him to do a better job if he should try to take one. I've taken one. You know what I mean? Yeah. I think it's interesting. You know?
You know, you are interesting. Let's just get that out of the way.
I'm glad you're interested in me.
Oh my God, I am very interested in the things that come out of your mouth. But I'll say that, don't you think that if you're in a monogamous relationship, mm-hmm. right? And you are with somebody and you'd say, if you were taking that drug, don't you think that you should be sharing that information with your spouse if you're married to them or if you're in a relationship with them? Don't you think that it's important that you share that information, that she just does not look in your bag and find it by accident?
Well, I would say it depends on the type of friendship that you have.
She's a relationship.
Yeah, but most people that are in these relationships are not friends. You know what I'm saying? And it's important to be friends with whoever you're in a relationship with. And a lot of these relationships, they're not friends. They have relationship based on agreements. You know, someone might be in a relationship with somebody because, hey, you know what I'm saying? She's a good cook. She makes sure I'm straight. I got a place to stay. Or maybe she helps with certain finances that I wouldn't be able to take care of on my own.
So you're saying, is it necessary to say it or not?
I would say that, I would say based on your friendship. Based on the friendship in the relationship. If you're not really friends with this person, like close friends like that.
But if you are living with her or if you're living together.
Does it make you friends?
I understand that. But you should be.
You should be.
And if you are not, then you shouldn't be doing the things that you are doing together. That's the bottom line.
That's the bottom line. I agree with you 100%.
Right? So I would say if you are, go ahead.
Wait up, 1 second. Let me break you. That's the bottom line, but it's not the reality.
True, but we need to try and impose that so that more people can live. They take a lot for granted. I'm going out with mm-hmm. Bern, for instance, and in my mind, I am assuming that Bern is my only guy. I just mm-hmm. assume that because he come here every day, he live in my house, la, 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 la. Mm-hmm. You know, I meet him last week, this week he living in my house. So right. I believe that he's my only man. We don't talk nothing, you know.
Right.
I just assume that Bern is thinking this is a cool girl.
Right.
I get to stay here, I get to do what I want, I get to come home. So now Bern have his idea and I have my idea. Nobody right. sit down and discuss the ideas.
Exactly.
So maybe Bern has a good point. Maybe the relationship that you think that you are in is not as solid as you think it is, so he doesn't feel the need to explain to you why he's doing and what he's doing with himself. Ask him and then move on.
Right.
You know, if he says it has nothing to do with you and it's not affecting you, I would then take different precautions simply because where I am is not where I thought I am.
Exactly.
Morning. I am listening to you discussing on the issue with cheating men. And the supposedly pregnant woman. Okay, let's just move on from that one. Morning, I am married for almost 14 years. My husband also have a woman that he has 3 children with, apart from me. And he still wants to be with me and keep me going and coming. I'm fed up. I prayed about it as I'm a Christian woman. All right, she's married almost 14 years and her husband has a woman with 3 children along with her. I don't know if she had them before, after, or during her. She's tired because he's playing both sides of the fence. What should she do?
Well, she should first off know what it is that she really wants. And if she really wants that man and she's okay with that situation, then just enjoy it. And if she's not, then she should get herself out of it. You know what I mean? A lot of times people don't really know what they want in a relationship. And what they think they want, they really don't want.
You know, it's like showing up home sometimes and you say, you ask your spouse, "You hungry?" He says, "Yes." And then you said, "What you want to eat?" He says, "I don't know." So you bring him cereal. He don't want cereal, but he will eat the cereal because that's what's there. He really, in his mind, he probably, if he had thought about it a little longer, he might have said, "You know, I want some mashed potatoes and eggs," or whatever the case is, right? But he ended up eating cereal because he never gave himself the opportunity to really sit and think what he wants. That's how a lot of people deal with their relationship. They're just in a relationship, "Oh, I want a man." They don't come with any other specification. Mm-hmm. So they end up with a man. I think what's happening here is that you are allowing this to happen to you. After 14 years, you continue. You can't blame him. He is who he is. He's showing you who he is. You can take it or leave it. He's not going to change. You need to be the change that you want for yourself.
Exactly. Top done. Exactly. I 100% agree with
My
that.
Boyfriend is going out for 3 years, but during the first year, he used to cheat on me. But for the past 2 years, he showed me that he has stopped cheating and even gave me a ring. I'm not sure if I should believe him.
Well, if you're not sure if you should believe him, then
give him back the ring.
Give him back the ring and go about your business. You know what I mean? Stop playing yourself and stop playing him. And most important, don't play yourself.
I don't think the problem now is he. When he was cheating, you never left him. Now that he's stopped cheating, gave you a ring, settled down, acting right, now you have a problem with what he did 2 years ago? No. You need to check yourself.
Right.
Maybe what you want to do is counsel yourself or go and get counseling for yourself and the relationship. And I say that because sometimes while we are willing to forgive, we don't mm-hmm. know how to forgive. We don't know how to deal with it. We need help. So a little counseling might be just what she needs.
Yeah. I think outside of counseling, she should just sit in the corner and think about what it is that she want. You know what I mean? Because if you want this man and this man has stopped cheating, he's behaving himself like she's saying, and now she want to be questioning what was going on a long time ago when she was there putting up with it and dealing with it. You know, I think she might just be setting herself up to ruin this relationship for him and her.
After he has come around.
Yeah.
You know, you can't be charging, if you're going to charge somebody for something, expect them to do the crime. If you continue to have this in your mind, I mean, if you're going to accuse him and wondering if he's cheating and still staying, what difference does it make if he's cheating or not?
Exactly.
Because you're still going through the same pain, you're still charging him for it, it's not healthy for anybody. On that note, we're going to take a break and come back with our third and final segment.
Cost of fuel these days, every fill up can be a curiously scary experience. Rising gas prices have transformed to the point where it feels like it can cost you the shirt off your back. That's why we created Lucas Fuel Saving Motor Oils. Their special additives increase compression and minimize friction, improving fuel mileage. With Lucas, you'll keep from losing your shirt, or even worse.
Welcome back to the third and final segment of Morning Matters right here in Belize City. Bern Velasquez in with us this morning. Quite an interesting guy. You know, when you look at him on the street, you might say he look hot until you open him out and tell the story. Then you know there's something special about this guy. I mean, having the option to choose between a 44-year-old prostitute and a 40-year-old virgin, not many men that can say that they have done that, right? this guy has. Well, that's just on the lighter note. He's really, really come a long way. He has persevered where a lot of people would have just failed and given up or maybe just gotten a job and make $300 a week. Now he's living his dream, exploring the world, just life, you know. I mean, he's not just alive now. He's actually living. Bern, I have to say that you are an example for a lot of people. I'm sure that when you share your story with them, they would be more than impressed. Speaking of stories, I think that you have out a documentary right now.
Well, I got a documentary I'm getting released called Broken Dreams. And Broken Dreams, pretty much, I feel is a project that's inspirational, uplifting, educating, motivational.
How did you come up with it?
Well, I basically, it's a reality project. You know what I mean? It's a project that happened. Broken Dreams happened. I didn't come up with it. This is not scripted. You know what I mean?
It's just a reality.
It's just reality.
I love it.
And then being able to capture the moment.
I was just gonna say, what made you think to document it?
Because I think I'm pretty amazing. I mean, I think that these stories are amazing as it happens.
I love it.
I mean, you know what? The first thing is me selling 215,000 CDs in Belize.
In a country that has less than
350,000. That's more than half the population of the country.
That would have had to include all children, all newborn. Everybody would have had to buy
pregnant
at least
women,
what?
Aborted kids, you know what I'm saying?
You count so, everything.
So I'm just saying. No, but then the thing is I have 10 projects. So one person might have 10 projects. So that counts for 10 sales.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
And I feel like that's amazing. When I cross the border from Corozal and I drive to Orange Walk, from Corozal to Orange Walk in that stretch, I think to myself and I say, I remember many times I would say, on this stretch, I'm going to make like $500. And to be able to make $500 within that drive from CD sales, I'm like, how did you really do that?
God's grace.
God's grace.
God's grace. And you know why? Because a lot of CD stores don't sell that kind of CD.
Exactly. Exactly.
And when you drive through that stretch of road, if you know Belize, it's not the richest stretch of road.
Not only that, there's no houses.
Thank
there's
you.
No people. I'm like, where are the houses that you sold the CDs? Where are the people? You know, when I used to turn some back street and I see, I'm like, okay, great. There's like 8 houses on this street. I know there's 8. I got to get at least 6. You know what I mean? And sometimes you are at a house. Hello? Hello? No, I'm like, burn, the place is boarded up. Leave. You know what I mean? The dog is going to bite you. Leave. I'm like, no, I'm not going to leave.
Somebody comes out, you take their last $5 and gone.
Don't put it that way. You make it sound like I robbed them.
You didn't, but it shows perseverance. It
right.
Really, really does. I mean, gosh, if one company was to have a salesman like you, I'm serious. That would be amazing. When are you going to release this project?
Broken Dreams. I'm going to feel a vibe in the country and then see if it's ready if it's time for me to release it. I'm going to pray about it. Feel the vibe of the country, feel the energy, and then decide. I'm in no rush. I have another project called Champion, ready to be released. Champion is a CD project, a music project. And that is my actually, it's the most important project I've completed. Because Champion, I have, at first, all the music I've done was about survival. It was about trying to get to a place that I can maintain myself and be able to live. Now I'm in the position to choose to say, hey, I don't like that song. I'm not gonna use that. That song won't make the album. I'm in the position to fly to a studio in anywhere in the world that I wanna record and record how I want to record. And so that gives me the authority to put together the type of project that I need to put together and want to put together. You understand? So it's a very important project to me. I've really taken the time to write every song, listen to the music, and to let the music give me the inspiration on the type of lyrics that will be delivered on this music.
What has been your biggest keep back? Your biggest challenge?
My biggest challenge?
Generally in life.
My biggest challenge in life has been working on a better me. You know, fixing me and the problems that I have brought upon myself.
Amen to that. You could not, I mean, and you know, you have said more than a mouthful, because a lot of people don't take responsibility for a lot of the problems that they find themselves in. And a lot of the times the problems we find ourselves in is because we made choices to get us there. So I am glad that you took full responsibility of that and have seen and worked on that. What has been, to date, what has been your biggest reward or your biggest blessing?
My biggest blessing is to see my son go from his mother's house, because I was never really living with him, but I've always been the best father I know how to be without knowing how to be a father. I never had a father, so much less you ain't never had a father, much less trying to learn to be a father. But I love my son and I would die for him, and I would do everything possible to try to provide the best life for him. Mm-hmm. And to see him be able to leave his mom's house and to work on his own, doing what it is that he've always dreamt about doing, and what it is that he really wants to do, because that's always been very important to me, that he's doing what he wants to do, that he goes to school, get a good education, that I would do whatever is necessary to try to make sure that this education is met.
Bern, how did you go from being, and I would use this term very loosely, unconscious, to so very conscious now?
You didn't use it loosely, because I was very unconscious, you know. And I went from being unconscious because I feel that society, the environment in which I lived, there were many negative influences. So when you have parents or people who are responsible for you that are more fighting for you to try to have food in your mouth, and they're trying to do everything to make sure that you don't go to bed hungry tonight, they can't really be watching your every move. So all the negative around you has a good chance to get to you.
How do you get conscious?
I got conscious by realizing how messed up I was. You know, I was arrogant with an inferiority complex. I was torn down to feel that I'm less than the next person who might have money.
What was the one thing that made you come to that realization? What was the one thing that said, that you said, you know what, I'm not that person. I'm not inferior. I am not what I thought I was. I am better than that. What was the defining moment for you?
It was many things that happened and many moments. I couldn't point to one moment to say this was what made that change. But for example, I had a friend, Tasha Curtis. And I remember first when I first saw Tasha, she was so sexy and so beautiful. And I was like, man, this is a beautiful girl, you know what I mean? And she opened her mouth, and she's so well-educated and so well-rounded. And I remember telling her, look, I want you to do me a favor. Whatever happens, don't take off your panties and don't let me have sex with you. And it's funny, because it was a game to get her to have sex with me.
Twisted as it is.
Well, she was like, what made you think I would do that anyway? I don't even know you, and you, I do not get down like that, and all that old kind of talk. And before you know it, she wanted to have sex with me. And I had already wanted to change my ways of thinking, but Tasha used to always just tell me. Tasha became a friend of mine, and she was like my first female friend. When I say, I mean friend, not just
you know, I understand, that, like your old dog friend.
Right, because I needed a friend. You know, I needed friends, and she was a friend. And she knew me, you know. So she was like, I used to have her check my messages for me and stuff like that. This is before you could check your message from somewhere else. So while I'm in New York, I'm going to have her in L.A. checking my message. I'm like, Tasha, check my message for me real quick. And she's like, oh, my God, Bern, you have all these women saying all these things, how they love you. Like, what do you tell these women? How do these women just be all so much in love with you? And I'm like, oh, whatever, you know what I mean? And she was like, I used to arrogantly feel like, yeah, I'm the shit. You know, these girls really like me and, you know, all of that about it. But she started telling me, man, you're very loose. You know what I mean? You're very loose with yourself. Bern, you don't know how important you are. You know, you are so much more than someone that should just be sleeping with these women. You know, you need to really see how valuable you are, man. But I was thinking to myself, like, she's just saying that because she want me to just be with just her. You know what
she
I mean?
She was talking some truth, though.
She was talking some truth. And she was like, man, you know, Bern, you know, why do you just be with all these women, and why do you have all these women just telling you they love you? Do that make you feel special? You don't need that to be special, Bern. You know, you are so special without all that, man. You are cool. And, you know, she's like, yeah, I'm in love with you, man, but still, you know. And I was like, man, you know,
she gave you something to think about.
So she gave me something to think about. So
that's how it went.
That was one start. That was one, well, that's one example out of many other situations.
All right. Well, before the day is finished, before the show is finished, we have to do at least two more matters. So let's jump into them because we still have a lot more to ask Bern. I'm in a relationship with a man for 4 years. I just had a baby for him and he has a wife. I'm not sure if I should tell her.
Wow. First and foremost, she needs to scold herself.
The man says, scold yourself. I love it.
You know, scold yourself. For putting yourself in that position.
Who says that? Scold yourself. Bern says it.
Scold yourself, gal. You know, I feel bad for you, sis. You know what I'm saying? First off, I feel bad for you. You need to pray on that situation because that is a travesty. You're bringing another life on earth into a bad situation because this man has a woman. And now you have chosen to be pregnant for him. I should hope that you guys could go to church together, find some counseling together. Church will usually offer free.
There's no together for them, you know, though, Bern, simply because it's unfortunate that she placed herself in this position. At the end of the day, the man didn't divorce his wife. He's not going to divorce his wife. He's still trying to keep her a secret. I don't think that it's necessary that you tell the wife. I think you need to, your relationship is with this man.
Right.
Allow this man to be a father to this child. Let him know that you're carrying this child and move on. Hopefully you can see that this situation is not good for you and not repeat the mistake that you made. This man will not be a husband to you. Allow him at least to be a father to his child.
Right.
And that's it. Don't try and make bad for anybody else. Because you're going to tell the wife, if you wanted to tell the wife something, you should have told the wife when you were messing with her husband. If you didn't tell her then stop messing with her husband. Allow this man to be a father to his child and keep your life moving.
Right. And do it nicely, please. Don't try to do it in a mean-spirited way. Accept responsibility for the wrongs that you did with this lady husband, and then allow him, like Rhonda said, to be a father and try to make it easy for him.
Of course, because he didn't go and rape you. You were willful in this. You were with him for 4 years before you got pregnant. You know better than that. I am living with a guy for a month now, but I noticed for the first sex, everything was good. Now we go to bed and he turns his back. And he get up before daylight from beside me and then only give me a kiss before he goes to work. He's 39. I am 40. He just break up with his ex that were together for a year. Now she has a baby for another guy. What do you think about that? Wait. I don't know if they broke up for a year ago or whatever the case is. So basically, you're with this man for a very short time. You live in a get already with him. And initially the sex was good and now he's just turning his back. This is what happened when you don't spend time to get to know him. He probably realized that he's in deeper than he thought. So now he's a little bit stressed. You know what I mean? He wanted some form of reprieve, but now he really found himself in hot water. But forget the man. What about you? Why do you think that it's okay to get a man in your house living in for a month? I don't know how long you dated him before he lived in with you. You're having sex with him and now he's not acting right. Sex is not the issue. The issue is in his head.
Yeah, because for most men, sex is more than just physical.
No.
Yes.
I think that them for most women.
For most men too. I feel like a lot of men, sex is more than just physical.
What you mean?
Because a man will look at a woman and be attracted to the physical first, but to maintain a constant wanting that same physical, it would be the spiritual, the mental would kick in. You know, does this woman have good conversation? Can this woman stimulate me? Sometimes you could talk to a woman and she's not even all that cute or sexy, or you're not even that physically attracted to her, but because of the things she's saying to you, you're stimulated and you want to have sex with her.
You get the plain Jane effect.
Is that what it's called?
I just call it that.
Okay. Because I want to learn.
Well, I don't know, but I can understand. I would call it the plain Jane effect. She just looks simple on the outside, but she would stimulate you in such a way that men... You don't see the plain Jane anymore.
Right.
She's just awesome.
Right. Now you see this woman who's stimulating.
I like that.
And then there's the pretty or the sexy woman who, you know, you might have sex with her where some guys might call it boring sex or whatever, or the guy's just not really stimulated by her sexual capabilities. And then he kind of lose interest. He's not all excited about it no more.
I think what Bern has just said is that maybe he was in it for the sex. The sex is done and there's nothing more to keep him.
Exactly.
So now he's not interested anymore. But beside all of that, I think you need to check yourself. You need to examine yourself. You have to make sure that you don't make these kind of mistakes. Ladies and gentlemen, when you find somebody out there, I mean, I'm not going to be here and say, well, you know, you're supposed to do this or do that. But what you should do is figure out what it is that you want from this person. Or from a relationship, because not everybody you meet you want a relationship with. Sometimes you just want to have relations.
Right.
And if you just want to have relations, be clear. Because if you just want to have relations and the other one wants to have a relationship, it's not going to work.
Right.
You have to be open, honest, and clear. I would say have a conversation with this man, find out where he is, meet him there. I don't mean physically, I mean in his head. And then you guys go from there. If what he's bringing to the table is not what you want to eat, or you don't even want to eat at his table, then you say, look, man, it's time for you to get up and out of here because this is not what I thought it was going to be. I made a mistake. So be it.
It's hard for most people to say they made a mistake.
No, but especially if you're making a mistake that's costing you still.
Right.
It's one mistake to cross the street with your coffee in your hand looking the next way and spill it. But to be doing that over and over and over again, not going to work. Bern, we're winding down. What is the one thing that you would want to leave our viewers with?
Just be good to yourself. You know what I mean? I would want to say, find out what it is in life that you will really enjoy doing and just do it. You know that it's okay to be yourself. You know, it's okay to be yourself and do what it is that you want to do.
I like
Everybody deserves to live the life that they really love.
I absolutely love that. Far too many people are not being themselves. They're being what somebody want them to be or what they think they should be and not be yourself. Like Bern said today, I would reiterate his words. I encourage you to be yourself, celebrate yourself, enjoy yourself. Until next time. Oh, but before I go, I have to tell you to look for Bern. Where can people find Bern?
You can find Bern.
And your music.
At go to my Facebook page. You could go to my YouTube channel. Go add me on Facebook. Follow me on Facebook. If you can't add me, just follow me. And try to support my projects, please, because my projects are used to teach, inspire, uplift, motivate, all positive. So I want to change the world with my music, and there's a lot of people who are counting on me to help them. And I'm constantly helping a lot. So when you help me, you're helping the world to be a better place. I appreciate you.
On that note, we're going to say it's been fun. Until next time, I encourage you to take care of yourselves and each other. This is Rhonda along with
Bern.
Say goodbye.